There's a nice denning area. That's in my very large hügelkultur. Look at that. First time I noticed that. This whole thing is a giant hügelkultur. There was a stand of balsam fir, and that's the very end of it. Right here where this shallow pond has been dug. And cut them all down, an excavator came in here and laid them all out in here. And the soil from the pond being dug went over the top of all these trees. Of course, there's a lot of cavities in between those trees that didn't get filled with soil. And whatever animal this is, found one of those cavities and dug some type of a den in there. So that's pretty cool. Here's a tree I planted that's dead. Right there is a locust. Here is a mulberry. And I'd say it's doing quite well being browse, and it's still shooting up here. For a couple of years straight, it wouldn't get past that tube because the deer would just eat it to nothing, but it's able to compete with the deer, which is good. One of these years, I'm gonna go ahead and graft the Illinois everbearing into it. And then, this is just a volunteer balsam poplar. And then I planted a whole bunch of black walnut in here just to see if I could get a couple of them to survive. I think they all are surviving. They get predated on, but the deer don't like them as much. It's not their first choice, so they don't eat these things down to the tube like they do other trees. So black walnuts are have a high probability of surviving the deer. The rodents don't girdle them, so they must have some chemical that withstands the rodents girdling them. So this one here is getting predated on pretty good. Look at that. Right there and right here. But it's still alive. Ooh, what was that? I don't know. Must have been a deer over there that jumped up, but I didn't hear anything other than that one crack. It got a charge out of me. So this black walnut I tubed, this was the very first one I planted, and I didn't know they would get eight. So I can take that tube off it. I probably should, because I don't have a knife with me. Because that sometimes that damages a tree, being in a tube all the time. And it looks pretty dry. They get all moldy, and I think it weakens their bark. Planted some blackberries in here, some thornless ones. Most all of them die. Thornless blackberries just don't make it here. And I planted some thorny ones that I transplanted, and they're barely, I mean, this is like 5 years old. Not really growing. Of course, this is kind of a wetter area here since I dug all the soil out of there. This is a thornless blackberry. Totally dead. I planted about 20 of them along this edge here. But that's how it goes. You plant experiments. I'm going to be coming back here and planting honey locusts up here more on the higher part of the hügelkultur. But this is the edge where the black walnuts are. And we have the honey locust, the mulberry. And I have a couple of, here's one right here. I planted some American persimmons in here. There's one. There's a couple in here too, I think, yeah, right here. And I had one for the first time get girdled by rodents down at my house. So I have to change my perspective on them, then I'm gonna have to tube them too, I guess. And this is an older one. Here's another one right here. So I planted like 10 of them in here, and there's three of them that I found that are alive. Right here, there's a blank spot. And this I want for honey locusts. I cut it down last year to reduce the goldenrod population. If you cut the goldenrod right before they go to seed, they don't come back the next year very well. They come back, but not very well. So this entire part of the hügelkultur I cut down. And it also helps to feed the deer, so that's the main reason why I'm doing it, but I also want to get some honey locusts planted in here. Forget what I planted in here. Whatever it is dead. What's in this cage? Another American persimmons right there. Okay, well that's good. So 4 out of 10 I found are alive. And sometimes I find them, they're alive. They send a new shoot out of the roots. So we'll see how many more of them come along. But this would be kind of nice to be a honey locust American persimmon stand. And I don't think I'm going to grow any persimmons up here unless we have a very warm summer. And that could be coming. I've been looking at the ice up at the Arctic, and it's becoming thinner. Every year, it seems like every year, there's a report that there's less ice. And I'm not talking about extent or its coverage. I'm talking about the thickness of the ice. And I read a report where there's very little old, really old ice. Like, there used to be old ice all over the place, and there's very little, like some 10% of what there used to be or something. And what that has done is changed the temperature difference between the equator and the North Pole. And that's what drives the jet stream. The wider that difference of temperature, the more narrow that jet stream is around the planet. And the closer that temperature becomes, then the jet stream starts to do this around the planet. And that's all we got right now. So we may have a couple summers here of American persimmons production. At least that's why I'm planting them, because wouldn't that be something to have American persimmons in the upper peninsula of Michigan? Upper persimmons. Now there may be somebody that's been doing the same thing, I don't know. But, trees can adapt. You may have to plant a million of them to get one that'll do it. And then you plant a million seeds from that tree. Well, maybe not a million, but you plant 1,000 seeds from that tree, and maybe another one will do it. And then you plant another 1,000 from that second tree, and maybe 50 will do it. That's how it works. So I should have put some gloves on. This is an area of canary grass. The brown stems are canary grass. You can see the larger blades of grass coming. That's canary grass. Then you see the narrow blades of grass. That is annual rye that I sowed in here last August. And I could tell the deer are in here. You can see here it's shorter to the ground. And you look a little farther off in the distance and the grasses are taller. So they're coming here to the edge and they're eating on it. Especially where this path is. I could see that here too in the next area that I planted with annual rye. In the background there, the grasses are taller in the foreground. They're shorter. So this is a swale mound that I had built in 2013, and I planted all kinds of trees on it. And they're barely alive, probably a combination of this subsoil clay and deer eating on them. So last year I finally got some cages together and caged them up. But you can see it right here. See if I get my hands through there right here. Just sprouting. All these cages represented one of these trees. And I think it was a combination of, I think I planted plum and persimmons, northern apricot. So what any of this is, I don't know. And I don't see anything. I think that one probably died. I caged it and then it died. Well, that's the thanks I get. Then there's some in here that I probably still don't know or realize are in here. Like right here. I could put that cage here. So this is a tree that I planted, you can tell. I might have cut that. Because I come in here with a sickle saw and cut all this down. Since I don't see anything here. We'll cage this one and find out. Put this one in. There, I hooked that branch through to help hold that steady. So we'll find out. Leaves will be out shortly. Oh, this cage has got this one bent up. There. This one looks like a mulberry. Look, it got the little leaves coming out of it. Look at that. There's another one that needs my attention. There. That's a hinge cut that I did of this poplar tree. So I cut that, or broke it right there. Still hanging on. We'll see if that holds it up. Get this down there. There. We'll see. I planted comfrey along here too. Well, the one thing that I did that really was a positive, I planted birdsfoot trefoil on this when I first dug it. And it's still growing in here. It is loosening the soil up. I am positive of it. 8 years of it now. And I just did one planting. It's really expensive stuff, but it does the job. And the deer, they don't eat it to nothing until really, really late. And by that time, it's completed its seeding cycle. And this is alive here. There's something here. And I planted something here. This feels, oh, that's, I don't know if there's anything alive down below. We'll see. But I had this mound all planted there. I mean, it was really pretty with tubes all the way along here. You get a vision. Oh, I'm gonna have this real nice line of trees here. Well, that doesn't work out that way. I mean, there's probably is ground that will work, but not this ground. This is probably the best one of all of them. I'm kind of hoping these are either American persimmons or northern apricots. Up to here. So it's all 3 feet. That's the best one of the whole batch. Until we get to the hügelkultur back there. I built a little hügelkultur mound and the trees are doing fabulously back there. There's a tree here that this tube was on, but I think a bear came through and knocked it down. The cage, that is. And I don't see the, oh, here it is right here. I noticed that last time, and then I didn't come over here and fix it. I'm trying to figure out where's the best position for it. If I get a stick, that ain't bad. I got sticks holding that one up, see that? There's one right there, there's one right here. bears love to come and mess with your tubes and your cages. So here's an innovation that I produced and made like a rail fence, and that was the anchor to put up this 2x3-inch welded wire fence around this area. I got about 10 American hazelnuts planted in here, and I know there's a couple of plums. And the hazelnuts definitely are benefiting from this, hugely so, because it was just getting predated on by the deer. The deer would eat them right down to the ground almost. Then I also have a couple of Swiss stone pines in here. There's one right there. That is like 6 years of growth. I think I planted them in 2014, so that might be 7 years now. Where's the other one right there? No, there it is. That's the tallest one. Might be 6 inches. I think there's one of those plum trees right there. Oh, here's a bigger one. Here's the largest one. This would be the tallest one back here planted in clay subsoil right here. This is as high as my chin right there. You can tell how it's all stubby all over. That's the deer were just eating them down to nothing. And I couldn't really put, I mean, I can put fence posts in here if I had an excavator digging holes. And this was the innovation, was split rail fence as the anchor. I'm pretty sure that this was a 50 foot plus another. This is I think was there's the connection right there. So from this corner all the way around this side and circling around to the position right there is 50 feet. Then I would guess there's at least another 20 foot of fence right there. And I had a couple of these around basically to protect clover planting or something. I had a big extensive one up here, but then I decided to change that to a canary grass experiment, which worked out very well. And all that amounted to was cutting it late July, early August, and it stayed green up until gun hunting season. And then I had another one down there where I planted, and I pulled all those out of here, and I used the wood for firewood last winter and made more cages for trees with the welded wire fence. But this one I'm leaving here because of the hazelnuts. And I don't know. The hazelnuts are growing real slow, probably still because of the clay subsoil. Let them go. Now they don't have the deer predating on them. I think that looks pretty neat. Oh, I never noticed that this tree had any fruit. And there's a fruit hanging on up there. So this is a crab apple. Look at it. Oh, that's pretty cool. That's the very first crabapple fruit that came off of this property here. I gotta grab it and see if there's a seed in there. I don't think I can hold it with this camera. Look at that. Your seeds right there. So we'll plant it in its little cocoon here someplace and monitor it. That's cool. This is a aronia bush that can't hold itself up because I had a cage around it. Now I've got these branches here supporting it. So The deer like eating aronia. But this is well over my head. This is at least 10 feet tall. Right here next to that crab apple, I just picked a crab apple off of for the first time ever. This is a plum tree. That's a pear tree right there, that green one. That I believe is another crab apple. That's another crab apple. And I think this whole thing is being supported by this black locust. We get this massive root system of black locust growing in here, and all these trees are feeding off it. I think that's why they've exploded upwards. Everything else is just next to nothing compared to these guys. So one black locust on maybe 30 foot long, 20 foot wide hügelkultur. And all these fruit trees are flourishing. I got some nut trees in here too. That's a, I got a couple of these American hazelnuts. I don't know what's back here, but I had a, oh, I found another one too. I didn't cage. So I don't know what this is, but it's starting to put out leaves. It's budding out. And I never caged it. You see it was predated on a few times, but it's growing some scarring here. And it's living. That's the kind of thing I like to see. And back here, I found another one that was living. And I caged it last year. I got a couple mulberries that I planted in here. And this one here got predated on by a porcupine. But this is a white mulberry and I'm gonna graft it. I grafted it last year, but the grafts failed. So I'm gonna graft it down below the wounds with Illinois everberry. And here's another one. I think this one might have died, actually. I think that one's dead. I had this whole mound covered in plants and trees, and I'm not sure why they died on this side of it, on the north side of the hügelkultur. Other than all, okay, I'm looking at a lot of rodent holes here, and maybe that's why. And over there, the maybe there was a few more rocks there and they couldn't dig in. It's possible. I'm not sure what that is. I think it's a plum. Yeah, that's a plum. And it was being predated on. I finally put a cage around that one. This is an American hazelnut, same thing. I might have planted 20 hazelnuts on here, and I think there's four or five at the most that are alive. But look at this aronia, it's just budding out like crazy already. That is really cool for being up here in the north. Or if you had a whole bunch of them, like 1,000 aronia planted in your land, that would be deer food right there. The deer would come to your property, and it holds its leaves late too. And then you have the birds come and eat the berries, and they'll fertilize everything. What a plant. I was thinking I had cedar waxwings on the property last year. I'm thinking maybe that's what was eating the aronias, which is a huge positive. Okay, I just need to make more hügelkulturs. I don't know if I want to bear the expense of an excavator anymore on this property. I did enough spending money on it, on experiments. Of course, now they're not experiments anymore. I know the hügelkulturs work between this one and that one and the ones up by the camp. There's one between. This here is just a mound of clay subsoil from digging that pond there. And we got a plum tree. I planted like 8 or 10 trees on this. We got a plum tree that likes it here. And really nothing else. I do have this mulberry growing, but it keeps dying back. I planted some thimbleberries in here. You can see the leaves there, so they are living. Planted this. Oh, this is a box elder. That's deer food. I just planted that just a week ago. And I'm gonna bring a honey locust back in here, and I'm planting a honey locust here today. And then I'm gonna plant the rest of the honey locust on that hügelkultur there. That's a giant one. That's like a 100-foot long hügelkultur. So I'm running out of battery. It's enough discourse for the morning. It's time to go plant some trees. This is a red osier dogwood that I planted, and you can see we're getting new shoots out of the root system, and we're getting a couple shoots growing straight up. And I expect this entire length of this main stem, and then plus these here, they're all going to have shoots. You can see this one's all having a shoot, that one's having a shoot. Then I'm expecting this to tip layer, because I stuck them in the ground. And you can see this one right here comes up here live and well. This one here comes up all right here live and well right here. I don't see any shoots coming out of here yet, but we'll have to monitor that. When we come to the end of the main stem here, right here, you see I put a rack on it to hold it down, and all this is alive and well. Look at that. It's all going to be food for the deer. Then in front of it, this is a Cornelian cherry, which is also part of that family. It's also doing very well. Look at it. And in front of that, I have a comfrey growing. You can see the leaves right here coming up. So that's going to shade the ground in front of the Cornelian cherry. Keep it moist, reduce evaporation. This is the best Cornelian cherry so far, right here. It's taller than 2 feet. I think I planted 25 in here, and there's a dozen still alive. So what this is a primary, a Cornelian cherry, the first two berms here that I had built. You can see the trough between them. It's been raining, so we've got good water holding capabilities here, and it's soaking up into the beds. And these first two rows have a dozen Cornelian cherries growing in. I'm hoping 3, 4, 5, you know, five of them make it. I'm going to be pretty happy about it. Then the understory is red osier dogwood, and there's both comfrey and rhubarb in here planted to reduce evaporation from the ground. And there's a plum in here. I think that's a plum, or is that a cherry? Prunus right there. And there's a Korean nut pine in here, right there in the end. There's a couple of aronia mixed in with this. And then on the back side of the second mound, I have a few other trees like plums and what's this one? Maybe that's a mulberry, I don't know. We'll find out when it leaves out. You can see I still have the dogwood here planted. I transplanted these. This is another one of those cherry trees that are alive. It gives a little tart cherry that would be good for the birds. I did put a couple of dogwood on this side, looks like. But primarily I loaded these two mounds up. Now I do have plans to put more dogwood in here. So I got a series of seven mounds in here that are like 60, 70 feet long, 5, 6 feet wide. And it's built so that this water will accumulate in the spring and hydrate the mounds. And we've got a lot of experiments going on to find out what likes to live in those conditions. All that dogwood is all deer food. Oh, here's another Korean nut pine. That's right, we've got three Korean nut pines in these two mounds. There's one there and there's one right there on the front side. So eventually that these will cast a lot of shade, but the carnelian cherries grow and they're on the salt side, on the sun side, and they grow pretty tall. So that'll be good. Good placement. There's another one of those cherries for wildlife. I forget what this one is. It's alive. Oh, that's a carnelian cherry. Yep. This is a plum or some type of plum right here. These are just kind of like a more of a wild plum. This is mostly all wildlife planting. If I get to glean a little bit, I'll be happy. Here's a crab apple. So my battery's flashing. I'm not going to last very much longer. But you can see the mounds right here. Just the mounded up, because this is all pretty... I mean, the whole property is tight clay. And water either just drains right off and everything dries out, or we somehow are able to capture the water. In this respect, it's in these channels which serve as paths, and then the mounds are wide enough that I think it'll support the root systems of these trees I'm planting. Keep them enough out of the water. That's what I'm believing. Now this all dries out. I mean, this is only going to last for till May, and this is all dry, but I'm believing all these mounds are fully hydrated to make it at least a year if dry conditions persist. And a lot of these trees now are 4 or 5 years old. They've got to have a good enough root system now. So primarily it's crab apples, carnelian cherries, wild plums, a couple of mulberries. I got one apple tree. One apple tree planted right there. There's honey locusts on the backside. Willows. Planted a few specialty willows in here on the backside. I still got more work to do. These two mounds here for sure I want to cover with red dogwood. This whole complex will be a deer feeding area for late fall. When all the leaves fall off the trees and deer are now nipping buds off everywhere they can, they're going to be coming here. And that's when rifle season starts. So I did some hinge cutting of red dogwood too, and it works pretty good to produce a lot more stems. That's pretty cool. This is a wild plum that was really getting predated on by deer, and I finally caged it up, and it's responding marvelously. This is a mulberry, similar. That almost looks like a dogwood. This might be a Chinese cornus, what the heck? Forget. It's got a Chinese. It's got a fruit too. So you can see here, here's a tube without a cage, and these sprouts grows really good in the tube, and then when anything that comes out of the tube, the deer eat. So this one deserves a tube, deserves a cage, because it's growing very well out of the tube. Well, that feels pliable. That's still alive. Amazing, this battery keeps going. That looks like a mulberry. Yep. Wow. I mean, I could spend hours and hours and hours chasing down all the stuff I planted. All right. Planted the crab apple seed right at the point of this fenced-in area, which has gone to stinging nettles. Have chicory in here. I'm still going to keep the cage up for a year and see what happens. But deer also eat stinging nettles. So next year, if we get a sprout out of it, I'll put a cage there. Next year, I'm going to take this cage down.